Come on in. Come on in.
Welcome, welcome.
All right.
Come on, 7 people.
Okay. All right, good to see you. How you doing tonight? All right, all right. Praise the Lord. Amen. Amen. God bless you.
God bless you.
Good to have you tonight. Amen. We're thanking God for you coming on into the room tonight. We're going to get ready to get started with our Facebook Live session. Amen. We are just privileged to have you come into our ministry tonight. Thank God. I want you to do 3 things for me tonight. I want you to like, and I want you to share, and I want you to look. There's our Cash App information, and if the word blesses you tonight, we'd like for you to sow a seed. Amen. Praise God. So we thank God for this opportunity to come into your homes and minister the word of God. I think we have a very relevant topic tonight that we're going to discuss. And First Lady and I are just going to share. We made some notes that we're going to follow. And so we ask that you would just invite somebody. Call up your mama. Call up your grandmama. Tell them to get on Facebook and watch the class tonight, the Bible class tonight.
Do a watch party. Yeah. And then you can tag other people into it and invite them to come and join you.
All right. Awesome. First Lady, let's go into prayer. Amen. And get things kicked off. Amen. Father, we thank you tonight, Lord, for your loving kindness and your tender mercy. We thank you for your great grace that is upon us, Lord. Father, we ask right now that you would bless us on tonight, Lord. Bless all those who are tuning in tonight, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Even those who will come on after the Bible class and watch it at a later date. God, I ask right now that your word would minister life and healing and encouragement to them now. Father, we pray right now for our leader, Lord, our pastor, Lord, Archbishop William Spain, Lord. We pray and lift him up right now in Jesus' name. We pray, Lord, for Lady Spain, Lord. We thank you for the blood of Jesus that covers them both, Lord, and that you would just protect them, Lord, and preserve them. God, we thank you for your healing virtue and power being released upon them now, Lord. We lift up Overseer Davis and Pastor Loretta Davis, Lord. We thank you for what you're doing in their lives, Lord. We thank you for all of the saints of the Most High God. Lord, keep them and deliver them, God. We thank you right now, Lord. Give us clarity of thought, Lord, precision in speech, Lord, that we may deliver your word to your people, now that your people may be encouraged. God, we thank you for all things. We thank you for the Saints of Victorious Life Fellowship Church, church mothers, and all the elderly, Lord. We thank you, Lord, for all the saints of the Most High God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord, right now. In Jesus' name we pray, Lord. Amen and amen.
Amen. Amen.
Amen. So tonight we're going to talk about the topic, struggle or strength in my struggle. That's going to be our topic tonight. And then we're going to focus on having strength in the midst of your struggle. So we want to encourage you. First of all, give us a definition of struggle, if you would.
So struggle is to make strenuous or violent effort in the face of difficulties or opposition.
Mm-hmm. Praise God. All right.
Amen.
So to make strenuous or violent effort in the face of difficulties or opposition. That's what it means to struggle. Mm-hmm. Now, one thing about a struggle that I want you to know is that whatever your struggle may be, is that if you call it a struggle, it means that you haven't given in to it. Praise God. And that's a blessing right there. So it means you haven't succumbed to the opposition that you're facing or the thing that you're opposing. It means that you haven't given up hope. Amen. And so you're making a conscious effort to resist, glory to God, the desire to give up, because it's easy to give up. The difference between success and failure is that somebody gave up, but somebody persevered and pressed through, amen? And so that you can't give up in the midst of your struggle, because you'll never walk in victory, praise God. So many people we've shared this story before, but when we first married, we were married very young, and we were very poor, extremely poor, and so one thing, even though we were poor, We never believed that that was our end lot in life. We believed that God would open up a door. We never just ascribed to being poor and just accepting the way things were.
Mm-hmm.
And so we believed that God would bring us out. And I remember this one time we were dealing with some financial issues, and we were living in that one-bedroom apartment. And our son, he was about three then, I think it was. That was before Jasmine came along. And we were talking, and I was talking to him, and I was asking him, what did he want to be when he grew up? And he said, I want to be a dad just like you. And I'll never forget those words, because I was at my lowest point at that time. I think we were about to be evicted, and, mm-hmm. and things were happening. And but we relied on the strength of God to navigate us through life's struggles. God blessed us, amen. And so I want to encourage you that during the pandemic, I understand that the struggle is real. Sometimes you feel like giving up, but I want to encourage you, amen, that you can find strength, amen, in the midst of your struggles.
So when we talk about struggle, people see us now. They see what we have now. They don't understand. We had to continue to be faithful to God, to
amen.
Give. And, you know, so when we see you going through, we don't just sympathize, we empathize with you because we've been there.
Amen.
We understand how we had to have decided, oh, we're not going to have a phone. And we're going to make sure that we have pampers for and milk for our child. That's a struggle. I mean, we had to make some decisions, and so when we talk to you from the point of struggle, we're not just saying it as a catchy phrase. We're saying it because we actually had to go through
Amen.
It.
Amen.
And so we can tell you what you have to do to get through.
Oh, that's good. That's good for
Amen.
Us. Because another side of that too is that if we whatever we're dealing with now, the struggles that we're facing now,
that's right.
What we can do is we can reach back from the past things that
that's
God brought
right.
us through, amen, and trust God to bring us even further through what we're dealing with right now. We used to sing an old song, y'all don't sing it much anymore, but it said, we've come this far by faith, leaning on the Lord.
Well, I tell you the new one we got. If he did it before, he can do it again.
Amen, amen.
So that's in my motto. If he did it before, he can do it again, and I trust him that he will not fail me.
Now, whatever you're struggling with, it may be lack or insufficient, it may be a habit or a stronghold.
Yeah.
Almost 100% of the time, what we do when we're struggling is we ask God to take it from us.
Mm-hmm.
We ask God to remove it from us. Amen.
I know that's right.
We feel as though the only way we can feel stronger is if God takes it from us.
Remove us out of that situation.
Because we don't want to feel weak, and we don't want people looking at us as if we're weak. So we want God to take the struggle from us. Glory to God. But the challenge is that we're trying to be strong in our own strength when we really should rely on the strength of God.
Right.
Amen.
Right.
The Bible says what? Be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Amen.
His might.
His that's might. Right. So that's where we get our strength. We don't get our strength, glory to God, from us being strong in our own ability and our own efforts. But we
right.
get our strength from being strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Now, what if you ask God to take the issue from you and he decides
to leave you
with the issue? Amen.
Mm-hmm.
Amen. He decides to leave you with the thing that makes you feel weak. And sometimes God does that intentionally so that we won't lean on our own strength, but we will lean on his strength.
Right.
Amen. He says, lean not to your own understanding, but in all your ways acknowledge me, and I will direct your path. Amen. God has promised us direction. Glory to God. He's promised us instruction.
Yes,
if we would just lean to him and not try to trust in our own abilities.
Amen.
Now, I'm reminded of a story. I think it's in Luke 22. And Jesus is having a conversation with Peter. He says, Simon, Simon, the devil has desired to sift you, to have you, that he may sift you as wheat. He said he really wants to get all the good stuff out of you. But Jesus says something. He says this. He said, I have prayed for you that your faith fail not. He didn't say he was going to take him out of it. He didn't say he was going to stop the devil from doing what he was doing. He said, I'm going to pray for you that your faith fail not.
Mm. While you in it?
I'm going to leave you in it. That's just to prove to the devil how strong I am, even through the weakness of man.
Wow.
Good God about it. God is awesome.
He's awesome.
Amen. So we're going to talk a little bit about the grace of God in the midst of our struggles. And First Lady, will you read our scripture, our first scripture tonight?
Our first scripture tonight is 2 Corinthians 12, 7 through 10. Again, 2 Corinthians 12, 7 through 10. At least I should be exalted above measure through the abundance of the revelations. There was given to me a thorn in my flesh, the messenger of Satan to buffet me. Least I should be exalted above measure.
Oh, hold on. A thorn in the flesh. The messenger of Satan. All right.
For this thing I besought the Lord thrice, that it might be departed from me.
For the thorn in my flesh, I asked the Lord three times to take it from me. Mm-hmm. You know how we do when we're going through something that's uncomfortable to us.
Give me out, Jesus.
Take it from me, Lord.
And he said unto me, my grace is sufficient for thee, for my strength is made perfect in weakness.
My strength is made perfect in weakness.
Most gladly, therefore, will I rather glory in my infirmities, that the power of Christ may rest upon me. Therefore, I take pleasure in infirmities, in reproaches, in necessities, in persecutions, in distresses, for Christ's sake. For when I am weak, then am I strong.
Amen. Only when I realize how weak I am.
Right.
Does the strength of God come upon me?
And then I realize.
That's right.
I'm strong.
That's right. Mm-hmm. But realize how strong he is in my weakness.
That's it. Ooh.
If you keep trying to say you strong in your own ability, then you nullify the strength of God.
Wow.
You can only get the strength of God by acknowledging that you're too weak to face all that you have to face. Glory to God.
And he can only do it when you are weak.
Amen. He can only do it.
So he can only do it when you are have that thorn in your flesh to prove yourself.
And we have a thorn. How many of us have a thorn in the flesh? We don't want to acknowledge, but we have a thorn in the flesh. Mm-hmm. Now, the reason for Paul's thorn in the flesh, you got to get this now, was because of the abundant revelations given to him by God.
Oh, wow.
So if you're not getting revelation in order to help the body of Christ,
right,
what you consider to be a thorn in the flesh is probably just you. That's not a thorn in the flesh, really. Mm-hmm. Because if you're not destroying the devil's kingdom, then you're not a threat to the devil.
Wow.
It's only when you start to witness the souls, when you start to be an encourager in the body of Christ. If you're a complainer, a whiner, a time stealer, the devil don't have to give you a thorn in the flesh. You ain't no impact to him. You really ain't doing nothing to agitate him.
He got you. What do he need to do?
If you get saved, that's not your only assignment.
Right.
You are to be saved and then to win souls for the kingdom of God. Mm-hmm. And see, Paul was using his revelation. Paul said, I asked the Lord three times to take this thing from me, all right? But obviously the Lord did not remove it, but God gave him a word, amen. Paul was uncomfortable with the thorn given him by Satan. Now, there are some things that we are uncomfortable with, but in order to move in the assignment that God has placed over our lives, we're going to have to be able to move forward, even being uncomfortable.
That's it.
Glory to God. We got to move forward. Because God really, most of the time, can I be honest with you? God wants to bless you outside your comfort zone. That's right. We have gotten too comfortable sometimes in the soft pews and the padded pews and being in the comfort of the church. And sometimes God is saying, I want to do something different in your life.
Right.
And so I've got to agitate you a little bit to get you to move and get you to move out. All right. So don't underestimate the purpose of the thorn. Its purpose is to stop us from having influence in the kingdom of God.
Right.
This is why I believe that we are not told what Paul's thorn in the flesh actually is. We're not told what his thorn in the flesh. Many have speculated. I've even tried to study that it was an eye disease and, you know, it was some type of sickness. But that's not the real issue. The thorn is not the issue. The grace is the issue.
And I believe the reason why he didn't point out what it was is because we would look at Paul and be like, oh, I'm able to go through that, and I can handle that. Mm-hmm. And so I don't know what his Paul issue was, and that's why he didn't show it, is because then we feel like we don't have an issue.
Yep.
And then we're bigger than that, because we were able to be bigger than Paul with what Paul had to go through.
Amen.
So whatever the issue was and whatever your thorn is, it's there for a reason, for a source of power and a source of anointing for you to be able to go on your knees, to be able to pray, for you to go to that level.
Mm. But first of all, you said something that was good, is that a lot of times we want to relate to people's issue. We
right.
want to relate to it. Mm-hmm. And that's a good thing, because, well, Paul, I'm dealing with the same thing Paul dealt with. I'm dealing with the same issue Jasmine's dealing with. The issue is not our focal point. The grace of God is our focal point.
That's it.
And that's why he said, whatever it is, my grace is sufficient. My grace is able to allow you to go through it.
Whatever it is,
all right? Mm-hmm. Now, whenever you work for the Lord, please know and understand this. The devil is not going to just allow you to do whatever you want to do for God. There will always mm-hmm. be opposition.
That's right.
There will all, amen. I think it's 1 Peter 4 or 1 Peter 5. It says, for as much then as Christ has suffered in the flesh, arm yourselves likewise. Mm-hmm. Be prepared to suffer the same way that Jesus suffered. Because God, Satan is not going to let you do the work of God without any opposition, without trying to frustrate you. Mm. But let me tell you this. When you work for God, God is obligated to protect you. Amen. You don't have to worry about anything. God will protect you. It doesn't mean you're not going to go through anything, but God's going to protect you even while you go through it. Amen. So will you give us our next scripture?
Our next scripture is Psalms 34:19. Again, Psalms 34:19. Many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord delivereth them, or him, out of them all.
So many are the afflictions of the righteous. You mean to tell me once I get saved, I still got to go through
issues?
I still got to go. I thought once I got saved that everything would be.
I'll be straight. I would never have to go through another.
I ain't got to go through nothing else. Mm-hmm. I'm good. The Lord is keeping me. The Lord is going. Look, the fact that you're going through it, you need to understand that God, it says that he delivers you out of them all. Before, you just go through. You just were dealing with one issue. This time, you got a comforter. The Holy Spirit, he said, I will pray the Father that he send you another comforter. We got a comforter, a paracletus that helps us as we go through whatever we need to go through. We're not going through any of this alone, but God is right there with us. Amen. So Paul deals with the thorn in the flesh by relying on God's word, that
Amen.
God's grace was sufficient. Now,
that's good.
You're going to be able to find strength in your struggle by relying on the word of God. Now, as we move forward, I want to use an acronym. I want to use the word ACT, A-C-T. Amen. That's going to be an acronym that we're going to use as we go forward. So the A, accept. Amen. Accept that the same grace that saved you is the same grace that can keep you. Accept that. The Bible says what? By grace are ye saved through faith. Not of works, lest any man should boast. It is the gift of God. We talk about this several times in Victorious Life, is that grace has a duality. Mm-hmm. It has a dual nature.
Right.
It is the saving power of God, but it's also the enabling power of God. God enables me through his grace to do what I could not do without it. Amen. And so he blesses me to be able to accomplish things that I know. Sometimes I've done things and I knew it was only by the grace of God. And don't get the big head when people pat you on the back and say, good job, Pastor, good job, so-and-so. And you're thinking like, man, the Lord revealed that to me. The Lord showed that to me. We just had an incident a couple weeks ago, where one of the cords broke on the... And the Lord just spoke to me and said, use another cord from something else and that should work. And it worked.
It worked.
Yeah. Oh, I'm so smart. I'm so intelligent. Man, let me tell you something. The more you try to steal God's glory, the less you will receive of God's glory.
Pride.
Amen. Amen. So you have God's grace for as long as you desire to walk in God's grace.
Right.
Now, I want to encourage, don't try to mix grace with works.
Uh-uh.
or else you'll frustrate the grace of God.
Mm-hmm.
That's why it says, for by grace are you saved through faith. Amen. And not of works, lest any man should boast. Because if man could brag about it, he would do it. Mm-hmm. It is the gift of God. It is the gift of God, all right? So we do the work of God because we have accepted and appreciated the grace of God. So that's A. Let's deal with C.
Confess your weakness to God so that the power of Christ may rest upon you. Confess your issues so that the enemy cannot use them against you.
Mm-hmm.
So when you confess and you tell on yourself, what can he use? He can't use it against you if you tell on yourself.
And that's the guilt. That's what we call guilt.
A guilt trip. That's what he tried to do. Mm-hmm. Exactly. And so I'm going to read 1 John 1:9. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness.
If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and then to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Now the text uses the word sins now. Not sin, but sins. Sins are actions. Sin is a nature. All right?
Tested.
But once you get born again, you have a new nature. You still may do some of the actions, but you got a new nature.
That's it.
All right? Don't let the enemy try to define you by some actions that you may have taken. Because you may have failed and made a mistake, but that means you're not saved. What it means is I got to remember who I am.
And the sin nature is I continue to act in it. I continue to do it.
That's right.
I don't feel guilty anymore about it. Or you might feel guilty, but you still do it. So when you decide, okay, this act I did, I want to repent, because we're not perfect. Bishop not perfect, I'm not perfect. Please don't think we
are. Oh, well, shoot. Can you stop this? Because we need to re-record that. I'm not perfect.
Whatever.
Okay.
Right. But I'm perfect, you know, in your eyes I am.
Oh, definitely.
But, you know, we're not perfect. We do things wrong. And don't let Satan tell you, oh, you did this thing wrong, and so you ain't saved no more because you sinned. Because I've seen people go down that wrong road and continue in the sin. If you did something wrong, confess it.
Confess
it. Allow God to heal you from whatever happened and move on. And don't let Satan make you feel guilty and feel bad about it. Where we go wrong is we continue to do it because we felt bad.
And
we never confess it and decide we're going to make a change.
And I think sometimes we don't understand the confession part is we need to confess the wrong, but we also need to confess the righteousness of God.
Right.
That we are the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus.
Speak the word.
Because if faith comes by hearing, I had to hear myself confess not just what I did, but now I've repented who I am. I need to confess who I am. I'm not what I did. I made a mistake, I did it, but I'm not that. I'm defined not by what I did. By what he did.
That's I'm confessing the word over myself.
Amen.
I did. I was wrong. And you know what, God? You said that I could confess to you and that you would restore me. You know, and speak that over yourself.
Speak it. Speak that word. Speak those things. Call those things that be not as though they were. Mm-hmm. Amen. Stop saying you're broke. You don't have any money.
That's right.
He never told us to confess what we have. Confess what you want.
That's right.
Amen.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
That's good.
Start thanking God for a large bank account. Start making those type of confessions, those faith confessions that will move you from being a victim to victory. That's powerful now. That's powerful. And you think about this. What is in Proverbs, I think, 18? It says that death and life are in the power of the tongue. Death and life are in the power of the tongue. We have death because that's what we confess. But if we want to confess life and abundant life, then that's we need to speak those things. Amen.
And he'll easily get you caught up with speaking death over yourself and speaking the negative and not the positive. We can quickly go there and stay there because we feel comfortable there. Because that's what we're doing right now. But to speak the life part and speak the things of Christ over ourselves, we struggle with that. And we shouldn't. Speak his word over yourself.
Amen.
And let the devil know he doesn't have control over you.
I think when you said that, I was reminded of this. because we don't tap in the spirit realm through fasting and through prayer and through study of the word, then what we touch, what we see, what we hear dominates our lives more than anything else. Mm-hmm. And so when you start tapping more into the physical realm rather than the spiritual realm,
right,
you speak everything you see and everything you hear, mm-hmm, rather than what the Lord wants you to speak. And I think that's just, getting back to our topic, struggle, strength in your struggle, is that you cannot always put yourself down or put,
right,
and think you're going to have strength. You don't get strength from that.
No.
The Bible says, I think it's in Jude, but ye beloved, building yourselves up on your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost, praying the Spirit, encourage. That's how you build yourself up. If you're going through something, you don't say, I don't know why I'm always going through. Why is it always me? That doesn't make me stronger. That makes me feel like I'm a victim.
Mm-hmm. And confess what you want, not
amen,
what you see.
Amen. Amen. Mm-hmm. So let's move to the T.
Okay.
And we just finished A and then C and then T. It's trust. All right. We must trust in the inexhaustible grace of God to be your strength in the midst of your struggle. In the midst of your struggle, there are times you don't see a way in the natural that God is going to bring you out. But there's a sense of peace because you know God. Amen. How can you? Sometimes it can be scary to you when you want, I'm not even that upset by that. Why? Because I'm learning to trust God.
That's it.
I'm learning to trust God.
I've been here before, so I know he can.
Come on. Say that again. You've been here before.
I've been here before, so I know he can do it.
Amen. Mm-hmm. You said it earlier. If you did it before,
he can do it again.
All right. Now, because you know God, you can trust that he will always do what's best for
that's
you.
Right.
God will always. Now, here's where we're going to probably have to leave the younger saints behind, is that he will always do what's best for you, even though it may not feel good to you.
Oh, wow.
He will always do what's best, even when it don't feel good. Sometimes God will let people walk out of your life, and it will almost break you. But he's doing what's best for you because they only meant harm for you.
Mm.
And so you got to get to the place in God that you're comfortable. That, Lord, I put, oh my, hallelujah, thank you, Lord. Father, I get out of the driver's seat and I trust, glory to God, the direction that you'll take in my life.
Mm.
My life is in your hands, amen. And that's the real only way for us to have strength in the struggle. So, first of all, you read our next scripture.
Our next scripture is Proverbs 3 and 5. Trust in the Lord with all thine heart, and lean not unto thine own understanding. So in order to have strength in your struggle, you're going to have to act on God's word. God is there for you.
That's right. That's right. So trust in the Lord, not with a piece of your heart, but with all your heart.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, the enemy can't tempt you or try you or test you in that part that you haven't committed to God. But I've committed my whole heart to God. Amen. Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart. Amen. Don't hold back on God. When you want all that God has for you, give your all to God. And that's the way you can really have strength in your struggle. So always remember this, that God is inextricably tied to his word. Meaning that God cannot separate himself from his word. God is his word.
That's right.
John 1 and 1, in the Apostolic Almanac says, what? In the beginning was the word.
Word. Mm-hmm.
The word was with God, and the word
was God.
Was God. God is his word. And the word is God. So we got to get that. So if God gave me his word, he really gave me himself. He made a covenant with me by himself. He said, because there was no greater, hallelujah, he swore by himself. That in blessing he would bless us, and multiplying he would multiply us. God wants to bless you so much, glory to God, that he offered Christ so that he would have an avenue, a thoroughfare in which to bless you. And the enemy is upset with that because there's nothing he can do about it. The only thing the enemy can do when God has set us up to bless us on that avenue by Christ, mm-hmm, is to get us off that street, to take us on detours and derailments.
Yeah.
But he can't do anything to stop it. It's already been done. If you step in the path that God has for your life, blessings are there. It doesn't mean they're not obstacles. It means that blessing is there.
That's good.
Amen. Blessings are not the absence of confusion or absence of chaos. That's not what it is. Mm-hmm. There can be confusion all around you, but God still gives you strength in the midst of your struggle. God can give you strength. You ain't got to worry about that. All right. So if you want God to do something, then remind him of what he said in his word concerning the thing that you're asking him to do. Now, it's not that God has forgot his word, but God takes joy in knowing that you took enough time to remember his word.
That's it.
And then to give him back his word. God said that his word will not return to him void. Hallelujah. Glory to God. But it shall accomplish that which he sent it, and shall prosper the thing that pleases him.
And we can't be afraid to tell God what you said you were going to do for me.
Come on, First Lady. Come on with
that. That's it. We can't be afraid to speak it and say, God, you told me if I paid my tithes and offering,
come on now.
You rebuked the devourer for my sake. You told me that I would have the fat of the land. You told me I could have this house, this car. I could have this relationship. I could have peace. Whatever it is, healing over my body, whatever it is, speak it. And don't be afraid to remind God of what he said in his word concerning you.
And when you said that, the topic is strength in the struggle, but even while you're struggling, you confessing your future. You speaking yourself into your future.
Right. You speaking what he already said.
What he already said he would do for us. Amen.
And the devil trying to make you to forget it in the struggle, what God said.
Come on now.
That's his whole reason for the struggle, is to get you to forget it.
Now, like I said, it's not that God forgot his word, but when you take time out to read his word, God is pleased that you thought enough of him to remind him of his promises to
us.
Right.
Amen.
And all the promises in him are yea and amen. Yeah. Praise God. And so I remember when we were dating, I wrote you a book of
poems.
A book of poems.
And don't do that no more, Bishop.
Okay. What is it about? Roses on the
Bible. No, that's okay.
But God has written us love letters. He's written us poems, love letters. Amen. And so if we take time out to read his love letters and study his love letters, and that's what it's all about. We didn't have much money, I think, at those times, and I would take, I took red construction paper and I cut it out. And
it was so cute.
And I made these poems.
And you put in little plastic covering. Oh, it was so nice. I still got it.
All right, praise God. Let's move on. Now, when you act on God's word, it doesn't remove the struggle from your life. It gives you strength to handle the struggles of life.
That's right.
When you act on God's word, it gives you strength to handle the struggles of life. When you accept, confess, and trust, amen. When Paul took his focus off the struggle and put his focus on God's grace, you never hear Paul mentioning that thorn in the flesh ever again.
That's right.
Because it was like the thorn, it was still there. But his focus was on the grace of God rather than the thorn that was in his flesh.
Ooh.
Glory to God. Hallelujah. You got to get to the place in God that even, I got pain in my body, but I ain't talking about the pain. Praise God. I'm talking about the one that can deliver me from the pain.
Focusing on the pain telling everybody about it. Every time I get a chance, I'm going to tell somebody. Mm-hmm. That's good.
And I think it was because he was acting upon the grace that was available to him. Now, that same grace is available to us. Mm-hmm. We just got to tap into it. That same grace is available. Man, can I be honest with you? You already have it. The grace of God. If you saved, you already have the grace of God.
That's right.
It's whether you choose to walk in. And I want to encourage you tonight that the only way to find strength in your struggle is to trust in the grace of God. Mm. It is inexhaustible. The grace of God is just, the Bible says it this way in Romans. It says, where sin did abound, grace did the more. Glory to God. That's powerful. That's powerful right there. And so you got to trust God in the midst of it. All right. Now, I'll tell you this, because sometimes we get confused. We look at some of the great men and women of God that may be on TV, and we think that they don't have struggles. Mm-hmm. they have the same struggles. They may not identical struggles that we have, But they have this, they have struggles just like we do. But they rely on the grace of God just like we have to. Amen.
That's right.
They've learned to focus on God's grace rather than give attention to the struggle.
And when we were at the conference for TEJT, he was talking about some of the struggles he had starting out. So we see people on TV and we see them now. And he even talked about even the struggles he still deal with now with some of the issues in church. And so we're looking like, wow, you deal with that too? Like, he's human? You human too? Yeah. So we all have struggles, a different type of struggles. Don't think because you're on TV or you got money or you got this that you're not going to immune from any struggle, any issue. You're going to have struggles, but on a different level. Sometimes the struggles that other people are dealing with is on a different level of another struggle.
Yeah, I mean, let's go back. When we first started in ministry, a little over 12 years ago, we started and we had an expedition. We stayed out of the car too, but we had an expedition and we would load the expedition up with the drums and with the keyboard and everything, mic stands and the mics and everything. And we put that in there, and then we get to the place that we were worshiping in. We have to unpack everything, set it up for an hour and a half service, break it down, pack it back up. And so at that particular time, that was a struggle we were dealing with.
A serious.
We had a family that we called them the Levites, because they would unpack everything and they would set it up. And we were at the end of service, we would pack it all up, put it in the car.
And it was a struggle because you had to get there extra early for just an hour and a half service and then spend 30 minutes trying to break it all down, put it back in the car, spend 20 minutes trying to put it back in the house.
Amen. And so we would do all that. And sometimes it would be, what, seven people at the service?
Seven people. For
but I'll never forget, even in that struggle, I'll never forget these words that I would always say, God, I thank you that the house is full. And we would always say those words and speak those words over the ministry. And I said, Lord, let your word go out in the street and draw people in. Mm-hmm. And so that was a struggle for us, dealing with that. We went from there and we got a building, and then we stayed there and the ministry started to grow and we were worshiping. But even that became a struggle because we were on a time frame and we had to get out, and the saints wanted to fellowship. If you ever attend one of our services now, you'll notice that they're not people who just pack it up and leave after service. They want to fellowship, they want to talk, because that's just who we are, a loving family.
We couldn't. We had to go to the parking lot, stand in the parking lot, and talk to each other.
And that was a struggle. But then we got in a place where we had our own place, and we were able to stay as long as we needed to. But even now, you know, we're looking at the capacity and some of the things that we want to do, and so we're dealing with some struggles right now. You're always going, many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord delivers them out of them all. Mm-hmm. You may be watching me now, and you remember when you used to make, you know, $8 an hour, but now you're making $15, but you still have struggles. You will always, but that's okay.
That is
God will give you his grace. Yes. Oh my God, hallelujah. Amen, amen. So whatever you give your focus to, that's the thing you empower. Mm. Whatever you give your focus to. So I would admonish you, let's choose to focus on God and his grace. And that will be the thing that empowers us.
Praise God.
Rather than our struggle or our situation. So I want to use another acronym, and that's UP. UP. All right, so we're going to use U. God's grace is unparalleled. His grace is unprecedented. His grace is unmatched. His grace is unfathomable. So if God's grace is unfathomable, we have to understand then that you cannot even begin to search out or understand the grace of God. It is so deep that you can't even, but guess what? It's available to us. Amen. And so the P, which is walking in power. So if we put it together, ACT and UP, go ahead and act up. It's all right to act up. The devil's been trying to domesticate the church when we were really designed to be radical. The church is always designed to be radical. The kingdom of God suffers violence, but the violent take it by force. Mm-hmm. We got to be radical. And I think that was the definition you gave, the struggle. Mm-hmm. The struggle, all right. So we got to understand that we're supposed to be rebels to the devil's way of doing things. We're supposed to rebel against the devil's way of doing things so that we can line up with the way God wants things done. So let's act up. let's realize that God has given us strength in the midst of our struggle. And walk in that. Walk in that. Don't think that you are the only. Don't get disillusioned by Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter. Don't get just Snapchat. Don't get disillusioned by all of
that. That's it.
People will try to make you think and paint pictures that they're not going through anything. Mm-hmm. The reason they're on there so much is because they're going through something they're trying to find an outlet for, rather than prayer and studying of God's word.
I believe this, they took 12 pictures to get the one they like that they wanted to post. So that right there was a struggle.
Amen. So we all going to go through something. Amen.
But amen.
I'm so glad that we had an opportunity to sort of speak to you tonight and just encourage you and let you know. I want to tell you from the bottom of our hearts that we believe in the God that's in you. And we believe that God has an assignment and an anointing on your life. And sometimes it seems, people will say, well, if God is with me and he's anointed me, why am I going through all that I'm going through?
That's it.
The devil wants you to give up.
That's why.
But God sent us tonight to tell you that you have strength in your struggle. Don't you give up. Don't you give up. If we have given up in year two, we would not be where we're at now. If we had given up in the second year, this year would be 31 years of marriage. If we had given up in year one, we would not be here. We would not have the grandchildren we have. We would not.
It's true.
The enemy has already, glory to God. And I didn't used to agree with this song, but the enemy has already peeked into your future to know what the outcome is going to be. So what he does is he tries to tries to stop you now to prevent what God wants to do later. Oh, I'm sorry, I should say it this way. To prevent now what God wants to manifest later. Because God has already done it. It's already been done. Mm-hmm. It's whether or not you're going to walk in order for it to be manifest.
He's waiting on you to get there.
That's right. It's already done. It's already done. There's no, God is so strategic. Let me tell you what God is so, can I make this last point? God is so strategic. Watch this. God is so strategic that he goes through creation and he doesn't make man until the sixth day. Now, why do you think he waits till the sixth day to make man?
Because he prepared everything and put it in place so that it already be there when he created man.
When man got there, it would already be there. Mm-hmm. So the creator is telling you is that I've already prepared everything you need. All I just need you to do is get there. If you don't give up now, but get to the place, God said it's already prepared for you. Everything Adam needed was already there.
That's it.
Everything you needed was already there. And so I want to encourage you tonight to realize that you have strength in your struggle. And so, amen. Thank God for
this. You can make it.
You can make it. Mm-hmm. So what we're going to do is we're going to close out in prayer, but I'm going to ask that the words bless you tonight, that you would sow a seed, amen, through Cash App. And I'm going to give you some information that on Sunday, we will not have our park and praise service. We're going to actually be in the sanctuary. We're going to ask you to watch us via Facebook Live on Sunday. Because of the heat on Sunday, it's supposed to be in the 90s, so we're not going to do park and praise. And we're not ready for our official opening, which we're planning for sometime in July. So we're going to ask that you will watch us on Facebook Live on Sunday. Tune in at 11 a.m. We'll be there with a word from the Lord.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. Amen. So I know there's a word from the Lord. So we're going to close out in prayer. We're going to ask God to give you the strength that you need. Amen. Father, we thank you right now in Jesus' name, Lord. Thank you, Lord, that you are our strength. Strength like no other. Hallelujah. God, we thank you right now that you will speak to us, God. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Father, I pray right now for that individual that was on the verge of giving up, God. Father, I pray right now for that person, glory to God, that was ready to throw in the towel, God. Hallelujah, glory to God. Father, I pray right now, glory to God, that you will release another level of strength upon them now. God, I thank you right now. Let them see their future, God. Hallelujah. Oh, God, give them another dream tonight, Lord, of what you want to do in their lives, God. Father, I thank you right now. Continue to bless all of your people, Lord, that we make it through this pandemic, Lord. In the name of Jesus, keep us all under your blood, Lord. Keep us safe, keep us healed, Lord. In the name of Jesus, let the blood of Jesus be applied to all the doorposts, God. In the name of Jesus. And God, we thank you right now for your presence. Thank you for this time that we've had to spend with you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for all families that are tuning in, God. I ask that you would strengthen them and fortify them, Lord. I thank you, Lord, for every single person, Lord, that you would bless them and anoint them, Lord. And Father, I thank you, Lord, that you're going to open up the windows of heaven and pull your people out, blessings that there be not room enough to receive. And God, we thank you for it now. Father, we call your people blessed. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
See you Sunday.
Amen. Thank you for joining us. God bless you.